There'll be no gold medal, in British rowing since 1948.
Everything was focused on that day. Everything was trying to win that gold medal.
We knew we had a good crew. We were up for it, motivated.
Up until 1983, the British rowing squad was organised on a system where the people would get together in their clubs, in their universities, then have a race-off, and the best crew would normally be selected for the Olympics or World Championships. Then in 1984, or in the 1984 season, that was changed to a squad system. We had all the selection process, and then we were thrown together in this rather unlikely four with Steve Redgrave and Andy Holmes and Martin Cross, all from different backgrounds, and our cox, Adrian Ellison. And in fact, the press were writing about us.
There was a well-known journalist that, of once we got into the four and then was selected, have nicknamed us the Unlikely Lads, and which really offended us, is that we all knew each other really quite well, and we may have come from slightly different backgrounds.
So we got some T-shirts printed saying the Unlikely Lads, and we raced in those T-shirts at Henley Regatta, which is the biggest sort of race in the UK.
We actually flew in on Independence Day, July the 4th, and our main opposition were the American crew, who we'd beaten one American crew in Lucerne. This was a new crew, so it was going to be about, you know, being in LA, the west coast of the Olympics, and racing the American crew. So we were incredibly excited. It's the first time I'd been to California, and I think the excitement was of the journey and the trip. We were there for quite a while to acclimatise. So there weren't really any nerves about the Olympics on the journey over, but we knew coming in on Independence Day, you know, it was a bit of a statement.
Going to Los Angeles, of Hollywood, it was just an amazing experience to be part of that. And going to your first games as a gold medal favourite was immense pressure.
We, of course, we went to a training camp first. We went down to San Diego. And we mimicked the situation that would be up in Santa Barbara, because the rowing canoeing was taking place up in Santa Barbara about, I don't know, several hours north of Los Angeles. So there's a satellite village. So we stayed on the coast in San Diego and trained on a lake almost an hour inland, which is exactly mimicking what was going to happen at the Olympics.
Physically, you always perform better in the afternoons than you do in the mornings, and you always perform better after a warm-up session than not. And so from day one of getting there, we were getting up at 3:45 in the morning of leaving the college where we were staying, driving down to Otay Lake, still dark, trying to stay awake to do our warm-up session, and then we would do a work session around race time, and we got into that routine.
It was hard to do. You see, the race was first thing in the morning at 7 o'clock, because to avoid the winds from the ocean, and so Coxed 4 was first event, which meant that we had to be up to prepare for it. But there was a time lag between Great Britain and California. And so we used that time lag, so we didn't attempt to adjust. We just got up early. Problem with that is it's all very well getting up at 3 o'clock in the morning, but you then have to go to bed at 7. That was the hard bit.
We just repeated that again and again and again, so it was completely automatic by the time we got to the race. We were the first race of the day, and it was misty, and we thought we were going to be delayed. So, and of course, we didn't notice it racing at the boat, but everyone talked about this race coming out of the mists.
This fog had covered the whole course, which in hindsight, I think it helped me. My first Olympics, 22, only been in one World Championship final and came last in that, is that it was pretty scary stuff. And thinking, they're not going to race. It's too foggy. They're not going to race. So you go through your routines, you get into your race kit, you go to the rest area, it starts ticking down to the time. Time ticks very slowly when you're waiting for finals. Olympic finals, very, very specially of that process. And then we meet by the boat an hour before. So we meet by the boat, go through race tactics, looking across the lake. There's no way. They're not going to race this. No problem. It's going to be delayed at least a day. They got time to put the hands on the boat, put the boat on the water, 30, 35 minutes to go, thinking, still not going to happen. Get on the boat, start doing our warm-up, and they're thinking, you can't see the end of the boat. You can't see anything around. It's not going to happen. We did our warm-up, and the warm-up course is away from the racetrack itself. Went across to the race course, started paddling down towards the start, and then you could hear the chug of the motor launches, the umpire launches coming up to the start. And they leave, they come in convoy very slowly. You couldn't see them, but you could hear this chug of these launches coming up. And that was the point, thought, it's going to be now, it's going to be here.
Of course, I'm very nervous. I'm thinking, yes, they can do it, it can only go wrong. And we covered every eventuality, so I was confident that nothing would go wrong. But nevertheless, it does raise skepticism, it does raise a little nerves.
I think we were in lane two, maybe. Yeah, I think lane two. And the Americans were in lane three. And the starter goes through the roll call, asking if everyone's ready. And I'm thinking, OK, this is it. We're favourites to win. And then everyone says you've got to be really positive of the situation and always have positive thoughts. And my last thought before of the race started, sitting there on the start, was, OK, I'm only 22. Is that I've got another 4 years, so if it doesn't go right today, I've at least got one more games in me.
The race plan was to go out and dominate the Americans. We'd actually beaten them comfortably in the heat and just dominate them again and push away. In fact, the Americans had different plans. They rode superbly. We were down all the way, and I had to take over making the calls from Adrian the Cox because it was a different situation tactically, and didn't seem anything we could do would pull us back.
United States and Great Britain, clearly now the race between those two for the gold and silver.
Then at halfway, which is 1,000 metres, we had this planned push, and we managed to get back a bit, but they were still significantly in the lead. At that point, we were beginning to get pretty worried. But we were a very strong crew in the second half. And then just with the last quarter to go 500 metres, we called a huge push. I remember Martin Cross shouting in the bow seat. And that somehow just raised us.
500 metres to go, half a length for the United States. And now they're beginning to show their burst. This is where the British will be strong, and this race is not over yet by any means.
And then coming up to the last 500 metres, they still had a lead on us. And we got a very good turn of speed, and we sort of pushed through the mists of Lake Casitas, crossing that line about half a length in front of the Americans. And that you'd think it'd be an elation of emotion of achieving your dreams, even though that it was 4 years earlier and I thought I may be Olympic champion. And I remember sitting back and I laid back in the back of the boat and said, I'm Olympic champion.
They've now got 20 metres to go and Britain are going to win the gold. Britain first, the United States second. They cross the line now and there is gold for Great Britain. Martin Cross, Richard Budgett, Andy Holmes, Stephen Redgrave, Adrian Ellison.
It was the first time we'd done anything. The crowd were behind us. There were a lot of supporters there, and the guys were happy. And that's the biggest thing for a coach, is when the guys are happy, then I'm happy.
We were favourites because we'd won the pre-Olympic regattas. And I remember a member of the eight coming up to me and saying, you're so lucky. All you've got to do is turn up and you'll win. But of course, in sport, it's never like that. And the race showed that, you know, we had to pull through to win. So it was just intense relief. And then it wasn't until we got to the podium that, you know, we felt the joy, or I did anyway, and tears started and all the rest of it.
It meant a lot. I really couldn't believe I was Olympic champion. In fact, I wasn't quite sure I deserved to be. Such was the thing. I'd normally seen East Germans and Russians winning it. So it was very strange for me. What made it was the guys that I'd rode with in school as a junior, being there, one lad, John Beattie, and my parents being there. And then, of course, the moment where you do see the Union Jack, Union flag go up the flagpole and the national anthem, which is an experience I never thought I'd have in sport, so magical.
There's a shot of us all on profile, and my Adam's apple sort of twitching a little bit. Because it was a morning race, we've packed up, everything's been put away. We're back in the village by 1 o'clock. And all your focus for my last 4 years of the disappointments of not going to the Moscow Games as an 18-year-old, of that disappointment, of then achieving your dreams, everything was focused on that day. Everything was trying to win that gold medal and have that medal put around your neck. And then you're in the situation of thinking, OK, what am I going to do next? Oh, not quite sure. No, I'm Olympic champion. Yeah! It's a very mixed emotion, because you're just focusing on that point. A lot of people retire at that point. It was early in my career, as it turned out to be. But if you're in business, is that you come to retire and you're actually, your last day at the office is a celebration. It's a celebration of what you've done. If you've done a good job and your colleagues think you've done a good job, you might have a gift or a party or a celebration of some sort. If you're an athlete, the last day at the office is the most important one of your sporting career.